Brianna Bolden's the big key. She has to have a good game if Charleston's going to be able to compete.
Yeah, any time that the Cougars aren't in a game or they've won games, Brianna Bolden has led the way.
A lot of basketball on tap today. First of four, and we're underway. The CAA quarterfinals, and it's the underdog that wins the tip as Nola Henry controls the ball. JMU comes out in man. They're going to be aggressive. Nice up and under from Booth gives Charleston the early lead.
And that's a really great start. That's exactly what the Cougars want to do. They want to attack inside, get the ball inside, and establish your bigs.
How important is a good start for College of Charleston for confidence sake?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, you want to get some momentum. You want to get a good start because if JMU, you know, they've come out and they've run up on teams early, and it's hard to come back when you dig a hole.
Perez the sharpshooter. Nickens the driver. It's Perez for an early three. And if JMU's making shots, it's going to be a long tournament for everybody else.
Yeah, Ashley Perez, she missed a few games this season, but boy, when they're hitting on all cylinders and she's hitting that three-point shot, boy, are they tough to beat.
Luna Castro, nice baseline drive to draw contact. Griffin called for the personal. You can get JMU's bigs into foul trouble. They are so aggressive, they are prone to some contact sometimes.
Absolutely, and I think right away you can see the game plan here for Charleston. They want to attack inside. They want to go right at those bigs, and if Jackie Lunacaster can get going, I mean, right now it's working.
Transfer from UC Santa Barbara, second season College of Charleston, with your college ball. Hoping that this is not her final game today. Numbers are good. 76% free throw shooter, and Charleston back up.
Yeah, Charleston kind of showing this. Not a real aggressive press, but they want to take some time off that shot clock and make JMU get into that half-court set.
Tough team to press, though, because they're so big, and Cooper Williams is headed to the stripe. They can just throw it right over the top.
And not only right over the top, you can see what JMU is trying to do. They're trying to pass the ball quickly up the sideline, not dribble through that press, and you have to get back as a trailer. You have to turn and run because you can't allow someone to set up on the block with no one there.
And it's not even just passing over the top. It's the vision over the top. You can't affect how they see the floor.
And that's a set that's run. A lot of times off of a free throw, you get the ball quickly, you go up the sideline, you see a lot of teams do that, and it's really, can that defense get back? Does that middle player in that press, do they retreat?
The foul, by the way, on Nola Henry, her first. So tied less than a minute in, and now pressure from JMU.
A little bit of whatever you can do, I can do better here by JMU. Both teams really aggressive here early in the game.
College of Charleston has got to protect the basketball. They're a team that is comfortable playing at a fast pace, but you have to be careful letting JMU control tempo as Booth hitting early.
And that's just a great shot. That's just a little bit of inside action with a little down screen and popping up. And JMU must close out on those shooters. You don't want to give College of Charleston too much confidence early on.
Booth's got 5 points in 90 seconds, and College of Charleston has its biggest lead early.
And Charleston really trying to push JMU out. They're trying to make them off the three-point line here and not allow them to get inside.
Perez is somebody you're going to have to watch from the perimeter, but she turns it over. There's the very sticky hands of Brianna Bolden.
And that right there is one of the many reasons why she is the defensive player of the year in the CAA. Already has 88 steals in this season alone.
She broke her own team record from a season ago. Nice move off the jumper, and Charleston's up five.
You know, and sometimes this is what happens. You know, College of Charleston played a game yesterday. They already have a little bit of a rhythm going, and JMU trying to get their legs under them and playing that noon game, a little bit out of your routine.
Mickens has really added that to her game, but can't find the rhythm early, and the ball goes back to College of Charleston. It is a very important thing. We talked about the confidence the College of Charleston and Kansas Jackson's team is looking for with the early start, but also because they played yesterday, you worry a little bit about running out of gas in the second half, so if you can build yourself some leeway, that would help.
Yeah, and a lot of times it's not that second game. It's not the second day. A lot of times you see teams run out of gas on that third day when you have to play three games in a row and your third game is the semifinal game.
College of Charleston would love to have that problem, but they turn the ball over here. Is Henry a little loose with the handle?
And Nola Henry thinking that that ball went off of JMU's foot, but she actually had touched it last.
Second turnover in the early going for College of Charleston. Look out, ball coming our way. And it goes right back to the Cougars.
Don't worry, Matt. I would have saved you there. I would have got my hand up.
I thought I saw you going backwards. I thought I had my hands up ready to go.
And see, and again, Charleston, not real aggressive with the press, but enough. You know, JMU, you want to back pass that. You don't want to pass forward in the backcourt. You want to back pass that and then go up and attack.
Bolden again into traffic, and look at the Duke swarm. You have to love Kenny Brooks' team, the way they hustle. Three bodies on the floor immediately, and the arrow gives it back their way.
I think right now, you know, very defensive-minded, both of these teams. Aggressive, getting a lot of hands, a lot of digs here, and collapsing, as you can see, Brianna Bolden, just not getting her hands on that ball.
Perez and Guatney both in there. On the perimeter, it was Destiny Jones, who was being a pest as well. Haley Barron in for the first time. Cooper Williams got stuck under the rim. Good decision by Huff. Luna Castro wide open.
All right, Jackie Luna Castro just having a great start here, but what a great job recognizing the trailer. Charleston really liking to use Luna Castro as that trailer.
And using one of JMU's most potent weapons against them. The Dukes love that play.
Yeah.
Barron got herself stuck. Another JMU turnover.
And that's a big thing. If JMU can get, if they could cause a few turnovers, if Charleston could cause JMU a few turnovers, then, a little bit of tightness might happen until they start to get in their rhythm and hit a couple shots. I'd like to see JMU try to get the ball into their player of the year.
Bolden from the outside. A good rebound by Cooper Williams.
One thing you want to make sure you do here if you're Charleston in transition, you have to stop that ball. You want to stop it above that three-point line.
Mickens, that was a tough shot. Cooper Williams barrels her out. And do you think the freshman pressing a little bit, give her credit for sticking with it, but almost seems as though she's just throwing it at the rim rather than shooting in the early going.
And that's really establishing yourself. That's squaring yourself up to the basket, understanding, she has a little bit of a height advantage. You could take your time, gather yourself, and get it up. Now, remember, this is her first CAA tournament. This is her first feel of what a tournament atmosphere is like.
Kenny Brooks going to sit her down to try to gather her thoughts over there on the bench, replaced by Griffin, who returns. The foul was on Luna Castro, her first. Perez left wide open. That's a shot she's got to hit.
And if you're Charleston, you really need to trail that screen there.
Bolden one on three. Easy call as Mickens takes yet another charge. That's her specialty.
Yeah, and Brianna Bolden just kind of losing control of the basketball. She did the right thing, taking the pull-up and not trying to plow into Mickens, but she just lost the handle a little bit, and Mickens doing a great job of stepping in and taking that charge.
It was one on three. Mickens saw it coming the whole way. Christine, last year she took 51 charges in one season, a ridiculous number.
That's phenomenal. And credit Haley Barron there. She got a hand on that, which caused Bolden to lose the handle a little bit there.
Perez moves into traffic and turns it over. JMU very sloppy with the ball in the early going.
Wow, and Perez flying into the water coolers there, just losing her balance. And the court is raised a little bit here. They do a really nice job of trying to angle it, but she kind of went off the court trying to save that basketball. Great hustle by Perez.
That's what we're talking about in the open. There is no tomorrow. You play like your season's on the line. Now, JMU would have a chance at an at-large bid if something were to happen this week in Upper Marlboro. But an opening round loss would make that argument much tougher.
Yeah, it's always really hard for the mid-majors to get those at-large bids. Kenny Brooks, they've set a new standard. 20 wins for a lot of teams is good. He says our standard's now 24.
Something they've achieved 11 straight years, but they're getting killed by Booth. Even though she couldn't finish, good board by Logan.
And Charleston really matches up well with Jamie because of the legitimate bigs that they have here.
Perez wide open off the extra feed, but Guatney on the second chance.
And so those are the little things that can get a team going. Jasmine Guathney just getting her hands on the ball, getting a put back, she'll start to feel her rhythm.
And that's why the transition three is a good shot.
Yep.
Still, Charleston up six. Surprising early start as Booth got it blocked, but a foul. Late whistle. Griffin called for the personal. And Charleston's going to be headed to the line when we come back. Kenny Brooks in a little disbelief. His team's struggling in the early going, down by six.
The CAA athlete has a lot of pride in what they do in the class.
Stats and highlights will go on to CAASports.com. The officials were over at the monitor trying to figure out who that last foul was on. It is, in fact, Griffin. So she has two. And as we talked about in the open, JMU's bigs are vulnerable to foul trouble. That has been one small issue Kenny Brooks has had to deal with this season as Kelsey Booth increases the lead for Charleston.
And you could tell right off the bat, that was College of Charleston. That was their game plan. They're pounding it into Luna Castro. They're pounding it into Booth. And it's paying off early.
And it helps that both players can step outside a little bit and extend the floor.
Anytime your bigs can trail and hit that three, that is such an advantage.
Try to run a trap at Barron. Good poise.
JMU totally missing down on the block there.
Guafi, tough shot. You need to get her going. And Bolden gets the board. Booth again. Oh, they had her. Booth slipped to the basket. It was wide open.
Yeah, that's where the recognition is. Not only making the pass, you have to have good timing. But Brianne Bolden realizing it wasn't there anymore and not forcing.
Luna Castro followed her own miss. And Charleston will get an extra possession out of it.
And that's not something you see very often either. You know, JMU giving up a lot of offensive rebounds. They do a pretty good job getting those defensive rebounds.
Especially when they're playing man.
Yep.
What a spin on Guafi, but she couldn't finish.
That's such a great matchup, too. Bolden against Guafi.
Two first-team All-CAA performers. Near steal. Good hands by Henry. It'll stay with JMU.
JMU just not looking settled right now. And I wouldn't say that they look tight. They're just turning it over. They had some good early shots with Perez, and they were spreading the floor. But I really think they need to try to pound that ball inside, look for the high-low, and reverse the basketball.
Doesn't it seem like Charleston is doing to JMU what JMU normally does to other teams, like putting the game in fast forward mode as Guafi misses and Bolden grabs another rebound?
And it's the little things that they're doing. You know, there you see Bree Bolden, you know, securing that rebound. It's about positioning and hitting the trailers and getting on the block. And right there is a perfect example of Kelsey Booth hitting the trailer. First, they hit it up high at the three-point line, so you're going to step out. And then she slips in, and they hit her trailing to the basket.
And Booth ends up at the line yet again as Destiny Jones gives up the foul. That's just good vision by Luna Castro.
And I always love it. Something I love is the big-to-big passing. You love that interior passing. When your big players can give those little touch passes to each other, that's always a lot of fun to watch.
Ashley Perez coming back in. You're a former point guard. You like all passes. Let's be honest.
That's true. I do. I don't like turnovers, but I love assists.
Tell you what, if you're trying to pull off an upset, though, you have to convert at the free throw line.
But the good thing right now, again, is the Cougars are really building up some of those fouls against JMU. They already have three early here.
Another turnover. Great rotation by Henry. What a catch by Booth.
And good job here, Bree Bolden, pulling the ball back out, giving it to Henry, and setting up a play in the final 15 seconds.
Again in the high post, Luna Castro feeling it.
Yeah, she's listed as only 6'2", but she looks a little bit bigger. She plays a little bit bigger out there, but what a beautiful shot. Again, when you have your bigs that can hit those, you know, 15 to 20-foot shots, yeah, that's dangerous.
Shocking start. Luna Castro has 7. Booth has 7. Charleston is up double digits. And another kneel steal by Bolden as the sloppy pass parade continues for JMU. That time it was Guafi.
Well, Charleston's doing a great job of, you know, you want to spread the floor if you're JMU, but when you're getting pushed out too far, then you have to kind of fake high, make a bounce pass, and you got to make the defense shift.
Guafi with the clock winding down. JMU just can't buy a bucket from the perimeter since Perez hit the first one.
And anytime those rebounds are hitting the floor before someone's getting them, that's like a rebounding drill. That's one of those drills you do at practice. Great job by Charleston just getting bodies on people.
To a man, boxing out. And a foul again against JMU. Barron shoving Luna Castro in the back.
And it's Charleston. You got to keep attacking just what they're doing. And they're really not doing anything special. They're hitting trailers. They're getting good position. And they're recognizing when they have position. Whenever you can see your bigs' numbers, you better get them the ball.
What a screen by Booth. She's doing everything, freeing up Bolden. Micken, smallest player on the floor with a rebound.
And this is the way JMU can get going, is in transition, but not when you have the steals leader, Bree Bolden. We like to call those back steals. Anytime you lose the ball and you can tip it from behind, that's a back steal.
A little poke check.
That's a lacrosse term right there.
Like the patience here from College of Charleston, up 10. Just over 90 seconds left in the quarter. Henry, tough shot. Attacking the glass, but it does go out off the Cougars.
But I love how Charleston's fighting for every ball as well. You know, Luna Castro getting in there, almost stealing that rebound away. Just like the way they're playing. I like the aggressiveness. It's not a desperate aggressiveness. It's just a really fundamental, calm, cool, collected aggressiveness.
So Plasia Brown comes in for the first time for College of Charleston. No panic, though, right now from Kenny Brooks. That's one of his really strong traits as a leader. Keeps everybody calm.
Well, you know, his team plays so free. When they make mistakes, you know, it's not like he's yanking them for every mistake that they're making. They get to play through some of those mistakes.
They need to make some shots, though, as Perez misses yet again. Bolden called for her second offensive foul of the opening quarter.
Yeah, she tried to sidestep. It looked like she was trying to get around there. Maybe should have taken that pull-up, but I really thought she was kind of sliding to the side to get around her.
Seems like a no-call, no?
Yeah.
So she'll have to sit. That's a huge, huge loss for College of Charleston. Candace Jackson having a long discussion with the official about that call.
Yeah, just like Griffin for JMU has two, now Bree Bolden with two on the other side.
Perez trying to get herself going, just can't find the range and huffed the board. Better job here by JMU of late, getting back in transition.
Again, nice movement, nice screens, pick and rolls. Charleston taking their time, reversing the basketball, looking into those bigs.
Luna Castro has nine, and JMU trailing by a dozen.
She's doing it from every spot on the floor. She's hitting the three. She's getting the block. Now she's hitting the turnaround. Watch out for Luna Castro.
Boy, would this send shockwaves through the rest of this tournament. Long way to go. Nickens hits the bottom of the rim. That's kind of an indication of how tough things have gone for JMU, and the arrow belongs to College of Charleston.
And I don't think it's so much that Charleston's, you know, up 12 points. I think that the fact that JMU has only scored 6 points in the first quarter is really what's shocking.
I'd say so.
I mean, teams start slow and you might fall behind a little bit, but for JMU, such a high-powered offense, to only score 6 points.
They have missed 12 of their last 13 shots, six in a row. They've turned it over six times in the last 8 minutes and 40 seconds. And Mickens, who always goes where she is on the floor, it's the bottom of the rim. You just don't see that from a player like Angela Muff Mickens, but Candace Jackson's defense has been solid.
What'll be real interesting, though, is that after this quarter ends, is the adjustments that are made and the response after they talk about it.
And remember, Calvin Charleston's going to have to survive a while without their best player, Bree Bolden. Good pressure break here. What an extra pass, and Booth has nine.
I'll tell you what, Luna Castro and Booth, the passing, the cutting, they are the difference right now.
14-point lead as JMU can't get a shot off to close out the quarter.
With the trailer there that you see, they're hitting trailers, they're getting those slip passes, big-to-big passes, establishing position on the block, and then once they start hitting that turnaround, watch out. But JMU, a very concerning six turnovers, only one assist.
Gaining confidence, Barron trying for the three. That was a big shot.
And if you remember what we said after that first quarter break, let's see the response. Let's see after they get to talk about it. Well, there's your answer.
Amazing difference it'll make when the ball goes through the cylinder, right?
And you can just see in the body language right now, JMU looking more intense, a little more pep in their step, showing a little more aggression.
So they foul by Henry. I think frustration. She made the good move but couldn't finish. And then the foul of the backcourt.
You know, again, with Bree Bolden with two fouls right there, being very vocal from the bench, but Candace Jackson has no other choice but to keep her on the bench for the second quarter. You're going to need her in the second half.
Charleston got a big break there. I thought the foul should have been called on Henry. It would have been her second. Instead, it was Huff. Wathme using the length, but again, can't finish. The ball bounces out to Logan.
But that's the shot you want. You want Wathme to get going. You want her attacking the basket. And you know things aren't going well when that shot rolls out for the player of the year.
JMU would love to buy a little time, having to play maybe the rest of this second quarter without Bolden with those two fouls. It'll probably depend on how things unfold.
And that's kind of the question. Can they maintain without her? And it's not that she's the leading scorer. You have Luna Castro and Booth leading the way with 9 points each, but Bree Bolden is your star. She is the calming and the defensive specialist.
Boy, Barron got herself stuck. And another JMU turnover.
And Barron a little upset. She felt like she got pushed out on the baseline there and showing some emotion.
Kenny Brooks telling his guard, pass the ball. It seems like JMU is trying to put a little too much on everybody's own shoulders.
And you figure there'll be a time where they settle in. They get a couple, you know, they string a couple shots together. You kind of get a couple of defensive stops. It's amazing how they can score in bunches.
What another nice pass from Luna Castro, but Henry could not connect. Great rebound from Griffin. Mickens, that's her specialty.
Just love seeing her in the open floor. She's one of those point guards. She can look you off. She can throw some no-look passes. I just love watching her in transition, free-flowing with the basketball.
We've seen walkthroughs where coaches are trying to draw up defense on JMU, and the first priority is always stop the ball with Mickens.
And you want to stop that ball between the three-point line and half court. You can't wait until she gets down there because she'll be throwing that pass to one of her trailers.
Look out now, that back flip. Good job by Henry to get out on it. But Barron open again. JMU, the iron has been unkind with the exception of that layup on the last one for Mickens.
And it was interesting because even in yesterday's games, it seemed that the side of the floor where JMU is, it just seemed like the shooting percentages weren't as good yesterday. It seemed like every team that shot down that way, just their shooting percentage went down. It was really interesting.
Well, they were worried about this building when the tournament first came here because the eyesight of the shooter, the backdrop behind the baskets, there's really no presence, so it can be tough to adjust to, but it really has not been all that bad in the years the tourney's been here. This is the last season, of course. It goes back to campus sites next year. It'll be at JMU as Barron fouling Huff, who will go to the line.
I just really love the game plan here of College of Charleston. They're spreading the floor, hitting trailers, but they're attacking. They're absolutely attacking. And when you see Huff, you know, taking on Barron, just trying to get to that basket, why not?
76% free throw shooter as Guatney returns for JMU. Has a second foul on Barron, who has to go out.
Barron gave them a really nice lift, though, coming out of that, the end of that first quarter when the second quarter started, nailing that three, and you just kind of sensed that maybe JMU was going to get going, but College of Charleston also responding.
Sophomore out of Burlington, Vermont. All she does is shoot threes. 159 of her 183 shot attempts this year have come from beyond the arc. An incredible number. It was 2 months into her career before she tried her first two. Mickens so creative off the dribble.
Yeah, and that's really where she's developed as a player. Since she arrived on campus, she was a ball distributor. She's a defensive specialist. But now that she can hit that mid-range jump shot and hit a couple of threes, that really has improved her game.
Still, though, College of Charleston maintaining that 9-point lead even without Bolden. Shot clock winding down, and that was a force as a result. Cooper Williams, the rebound.
And that's the difference where Luna Castro has to create her own shot instead of just receiving the basketball.
Watney can't get the roll. Perez is fouled, and she'll go to the line for a pair.
You know, it is really interesting. JMU right now currently with 13 points. They average 70 points per game. So there's a lot of room to make up there if they're going to hit their average.
Last time against College of Charleston, they dropped 76 of the Cougars. And we're not talking about a month or two ago. We're talking about 6 days ago. That was a weird circumstance. Everybody else wrapped up conference play 8 days ago. But because of a snowstorm in January, College of Charleston and JMU's game was postponed. And it was actually played last weekend, all the way down there at College of Charleston. So JMU, you thought it would be an advantage. They wouldn't have to have that long layoff. But it has not been early, although an unforced air gives it back to the Dukes.
And that's the right pass to make right there. That is exactly the proper pass. But Booth just firing that ball, going right out of bounds, and Huff couldn't handle it.
That's where you have to be careful against JMU. They can force you to panic a little bit. They're so long, so athletic. Right now, though, really struggling to make shots. Nickens trying to get him going. Ends up with her own miss.
Seems like much of what JMU's been doing, they've had to create their own shots. They're much better when they average a good amount of assists per game. You got to reverse that basketball, and a lot of one-on-one plays right now with Mickens and Guafmi, and you want to be able to spread that floor and penetrate and kick.
She's improved offensively, but she cannot lead them in terms of scoring. They need to get Guafmi going. Only 2 points for the conference player of the year.
When Perez is on one side, and Barron's on the other, and they have shooters, then it really extends that defense.
Logan draws the contact from Guafmi, and another trip to the line for College of Charleston. Their 9th and 10th free throws of the game already.
And that's exactly what you need to do. You need to try to get JMU into foul trouble, get those free points, get those easy points at the foul line.
The good news for JMU, it's only Guafmi's first. And the better news, Charleston's 3rd missed free throw of the game, Candace Jackson, product of Michigan State. She's only 31 years of age. You want to talk about a coach on the rise in her profession, but her team not helping itself.
As a team, they average about 72% on their free throws, and they're going to have to meet that or exceed that if they're going to hang on here.
Tough catch for Guafmi. That arm span is so impressive, but the jumper's just not on right now.
Just so athletic. She can do so many things. She can create her shot in so many ways, and she really has a great shot, and she releases it after she jumps, and it makes it very difficult to block.
Luna Castro again.
Wow. Well, whatever she ate for breakfast, I want some.
She's got 12. She is a 40% three-point shooter, but not a high-volume shooter. 2 of 2 today.
But that's where JMU has to make that adjustment. When she's trailing or getting her foot on the line, on the three-point line, you have to at least close out. You have to at least attempt to close out.
8th turnover on the game against JMU. Charleston still up double digits, more than halfway through this second quarter.
Very well in the quarterfinal round, but really the story of today is 2 things. 8 turnovers by JMU, and then just the play of the Charleston bigs, Jackie Luna Castro and Kelsey Booth, really just coming to play. JMU only shooting 21.7%.
Jasmine Guafmi has missed 6 of her 7 shots from the floor, the CAA Player of the Year. But there's Cooper Williams, the Freshman of the Year, with a block shot. Although, give credit to College of Charleston, hustling down another loose ball, but they turn it right back over.
And as of now, Charleston has been doing a good job, more assists than turnovers in this game.
Perez is somebody that could catch fire. She has 7. And JMU back to within 8.
It seems like every time JMU comes out of a break, Ashley Perez hits a big shot to try to get them going.
7 career 20-plus point performances in her 2 years with the Dukes. Transfer from St. John's. Logan, nice take.
Yeah, Deja Logan, she's had some really good games this year. She started 3 games this year, and really just a great role player for this Cougars team.
Energy off the bench. Guafmi, again, can't find the range.
Yeah, it's pretty amazing, too, that the Cougars have been able to maintain this lead, leading by 14 after the first quarter, but with Bree Bolden on the bench, able to maintain a double-digit lead thus far.
Booth was making that early. Perez the rebound. Perez in her trail technique. That's a shot that's been automatic all season.
How many times have we seen Muff Nickens make that little back pass? You're going to start to see teams in the CAA doing that regularly. That's something that JMU practices. She loves that little back pass.
Great extra pass. Logan couldn't find it. And Cooper Williams, good rebound in traffic.
Starting to see Charleston with a lot of one-and-dones now, not really getting to the offensive boards.
Barron, again, another miss. Guafmi, that time she gets it.
Such a tough shot there, Jasmine Guafmi, getting that rebound. But see how she felt where the defender was and then fading away. And that's a shot she can consistently hit. You don't always like to see players fading away from the basket, but the CAA Player of the Year has consistently hit that throughout the whole season.
Charleston played at a fever pitch in the first quarter. They've slowed it down in the second quarter with Bolden in foul trouble. I think they're just trying to survive with lead intact going into the locker room.
And that's exactly right. The last 2 minutes of this game, you want to close out well.
Logan As the shot clock was winding down, walked me the board, another one and done.
And that's been kind of the story the last four possessions here for Charleston, not crashing.
2014, 2015, eight CAA championship game appearances, and if they can get it going here offensively, how big would that be to lift them into the locker room?
Now the last two breaks, after the first quarter, Perez hit a big shot. After the last time out, Perez came out and hit a big shot. Let's see who gets the call now.
They're really extending on Perez.
I would too.
I agree. Watney deep two. She's starting to heat up. Two in a row for the CAA Player of the Year.
She just has such great elevation on her shot and great rotation. She just a really pure shooter there.
Down to a six-point Charleston lead. But Watney single-handedly taking away the corner three in that 2-3 zone.
Got to reverse the basketball if you're Charleston. Too much overloading right now. I figure you don't have it with those shot clock winding down.
Luna Castro, that bitter sweet spot in this first half.
It's amazing what happens when the ball goes in versus when it doesn't. Get that momentum.
Tough shot for Perez over Logan.
Again, Kenny Brooks taking that timeout with 2:10 to go. Wanting to talk about things, and now they're closing out this half very well on a great run here.
Charleston has to find a way to maintain this lead. They'll get Bolden back in the second half. Huge three for Logan. Tried to bank it in. And give Perez credit in amongst the trees for the board.
Now, if you're Charleston, you want to try to get a really good stop and secure this rebound. And if you're JMU, I'd be looking for Ashley Perez.
Good news is JMU couldn't get the shot quick enough for the two-for-one. Well, if Charleston's smart, no way they should not be at least leading at the half. Watney again. Good box out by Luna Castro, and there's the second foul on Cooper Williams.
See, and that's with 22.6 left to go. That's a huge foul. Huge foul.
I beg your pardon, only her first.
Okay, not so huge.
Still a big time box out and rebound from Luna Castro. And a kick ball is Guapi. Uses whatever length she needs. She's got long arms, long legs. She's a pest. She's athletic. She can shoot the ball. There's a reason why. There's a lot of people that think she's going to be a WNBA player.
And I think so as well. I think she's just got that length. And she'll get a little stronger. But the one thing you don't want to do here for Charleston is turn the ball over.
And they want to talk it over. Candace Jackson taking her timeout. You put Brianna Bolden back in for this last offensive possession. Remember, hey, who? Now Candace Jackson drawing it up. Elects to leave Bree Bolden over there on the bench. No matter what, the eighth-seeded Cougars will take a lead into the locker room. The question is, how big will that lead be, and will they have some momentum going into intermission?
I think what you're looking for is Luna Castro or Booth. I think you get it into your bigs. Let them establish on the block and get it into your bigs.
Final 5 seconds. They got Huff wide open. And that is the end of the opening half. An impressive first 20 minutes for Charleston. Charleston, but give the regulars a chance to credit. They got back in the game.
Yeah, and you knew that would happen, Spark.
The underdog will begin with the basketball. College of Charleston, just 11 wins all year. Second season under Candace Jackson, building her program from scratch. And what a huge brick that would be in the building process if they could pull off this upset today. Bolden back in. See if they can get her some early shots. Off one dribble. Luna Castro can't pick up where she left off in the second half.
Yeah, Griffin was playing Luna Castro on that high side. I think she had position where she could have got that entry pass in, but they missed her.
Charleston still in that zone, trying to force everything along the perimeter. Cooper Williams was quiet, the freshman of the year. Bailed out by the player of the year, although only five to shoot. Mickens slipped and walked.
And not a horrible set for JMU in the fact that they spread the floor and they got a couple looks that they liked. Just, you know, the air ball and then Muffin is just slipping. nothing you could do about that.
That's a shot Cooper Williams normally makes.
Yep. She wasn't square, though. Your shoulders tell you everything, and her shoulders were not square to the basket.
Luda Castro a little bit late. Guapney came in and got the deflection. One on two. Mickens doesn't care.
Gotta love when the little guards go up into the trees in transition, and no fear from Muff Mickens.
Used her body to shield the shot, but Booth, the immediate answer.
And I think that, you know, that's the difference for College of Charleston, why they can play and stick with JMU, because of the bigs, because, you know, we've said it over and over again with Booth and Griffin, they just attack and they can establish that position, and it forces you to play honest defense down on the block.
Griffin didn't play many minutes in that first half, picking up the two fouls. Her big presence inside should help. But Guapney got stuck and walked yet again. Two more turnovers in the first minute plus of this second half for JMU.
And that's already double-digit turnovers in this game. They have 10. They average about 13 per game. And, you know, to have 10 at this time just tells you the hardships they've had on the offensive end.
Bad timing, to say the least. Patience from Bolden. Nifty move. Booth tried to keep it alive, but Cooper Williams to the loose ball.
I think Bolden was surprised how open she was after that spin. She could have took one more dribble and gone all the way to the basket.
Double dribble. Perez uncomfortable in the corner.
The 11th turnover now.
Great piece of coaching there by Kenny Brooks. He just stood up and told every single player, calm down.
And again, you know, you think of everything that goes into this game. Playing at noon, JMU hasn't had a game yet. These two teams played 6 days ago, and Charleston just looking like the looser team right now. I think JMU is forced to play them honestly as well, because Charleston showed that when they spread the floor, they put it on the floor to attack the basket. So you can't go flying, but what a great block.
Big block by Guapney there. Perez. Cooper Williams sticks with it and is headed to the line. Boy, if JMU can get the transition game going, that can make up for some rough shooting.
You know, a lot of times after they get a main shot, they'll get into their pressure defense as well. So, you know, it's amazing what happens when the ball goes in the basket. But what a block by Guapney, flying in there and just swatting that ball. But when you could block the shot into your teammate's hand instead of blocking it out of bounds, or, you know, but you're able to maintain possession after you block the shot.
Cooper Williams, though, rough free throw shooter, less than 50% on the season. As Candace Jackson looks on anxiously. Almost as good a shooter from the field as she is from the stripe. Stays true to her average.
And here's what we talk about. When the ball goes in the basket, JMU likes to put that full court pressure on.
Good break, though, from Charleston. Turns it into a fast break. And a trip to the line for Kelsey Booth.
And I thought Darian Huff made that pass a little bit too late, but Booth catching it at the time that she did, forcing the foul. Great job.
Used that body, saw she had Guapney off balance, and just lunged into her attack. Have to start making free throws, though. The fifth miss in 11 tries for College of Charleston.
And that's just not going to do it. When you're leaving 5 points hanging out there against the number one team in the conference, you have to hit those free throws.
Lead restored to four, right where it was at intermission.
JMU really overloading the right side there and leaving the entire left side open and looking for those high-low, kind of that triangle area with the mid-post, low-post, and wing.
Guapney tried to force it. Cooper Williams, good hustle, but then nearly turns it over. Five to shoot for the Dukes. Perez ends up wide open. They just can't find the range.
Bold and lucky there. I thought she gave Griffin a little nudge there to force her out of bounds, but no call.
That ended up a great shot for JMU. That's the exact person you want on the exact portion of the floor where she feels most comfortable.
See, love the little things there, what Bree Bolden does. She catches the ball in the middle of the floor and swings it low, faces up before she takes off. Many players kind of do like the wide receiver catch and travel or get an offensive foul.
Tough pass from Perez. Another turnover. Number 12 in a game for JMU.
really piling up. When you're giving the opposite team that many extra possessions and you're turning it over, it really does start to add up, almost at their season average.
Bresnahan's 3 weeks with a high ankle sprain. Returned a couple of weeks back and really has gotten back into form. She struggled with her shot first couple of games, but no issues down the stretch. Luna Castro had it taken away by Perez. Had Guathmi with her, tried to do it herself, and Bolden the rebound. So quick in the open floor, but Nickens pulls down the rebound. A track meet's broken out. Good decision there to slow things up. A rare three for Mickens. It's not her game. And then Jones missed from point blank range. And a tie up. Arrow keeps it with JMU.
What a frantic pace there. Back and forth. Just both teams getting great looks at the basket, but no one able to convert.
Well, it must feel like there's a lid on it right now for JMU.
And even when they get the rebound, you know, just not getting it clean enough. And Perez getting her hands into everything, getting the steal down on the defensive end, forcing a jump ball there for her team, doing everything she can.
She and Cooper Williams will get a break. Turnover number 13 for the Dukes.
Yeah, just things not going well on the offensive end for JMU. As far as handle, even when they're catching the basketball, it seems like they're bobbling it or it's getting tipped. Nothing clean, nothing sharp.
That was unforced, too, on a inbounds pass. That's really got a chagrin, Kenny Bro. Trying to get the ball back inside. Pretty good job by Destiny Jones to deny it.
Yeah, Charleston missing Kelsey Booth, begging for the basketball.
Bolden turned it over. Mickens that pull up. JMU crashing the offensive glass in waves all of a sudden. So 5 minutes into this third quarter. It's exactly where it was at the half. The eighth-seeded College of Charleston leading.
Bobbling everything. But Charleston has really cooled off here in the second half as well. They're only 1-for-6, shooting 16.7%. So both teams kind of struggling here in the second half.
It's a great point. We've talked all about JMU's offensive struggles, but College of Charleston could easily have a much larger lead. Both teams have been cold lately. 10 combined misses in a row between the two clubs.
Yeah, and each team only has one field goal so far in the second half.
Jones, that's point blank for her. That's normally right in her sweet spot.
And it just feels when things aren't going well, those are the shots that have to go down if you're going to try to start getting some momentum. College of Charleston, again, they're not making a lot of shots, but they're spreading the floor well, and they're really making JMU work on the defensive end.
57% shooter Destiny Jones is, and she can't make that one. Great hustle by Luna Castro, ends up with Booth wide open.
What a play, what a hustle play by College of Charleston. And, you know, there was such a big mismatch there with Huff and Griffin, and she could have taken Griffin right to the basket, but it was the hustle, getting on the floor.
And the vision, too, on top of that, Mickens fouled plus the basket.
Add that one to the highlight reel of Muff Mickens. Great distributor of the basketball, but show a little flair there with the half reverse.
We talked all season and all day about that little back pass that she's perfected. She's also pretty good at the back flip to the bucket, huh?
I'll tell you what, it's all about the flick of the wrist there. She's got a little tape there on her right wrist, and sometimes when you bend your thumb back a little too much, that looks like the tape job it is, but she's got a nice little flick of the wrist, whether it's passing or shooting. Nice shot. Nice take, too.
Cooper Williams returned. She has struggled offensively today. But give her credit, not letting that side of the floor affect her work on the glass. 11 boards already. Meanwhile, Mickens, 9 points today. And JMU back within a single possession.
And Coach Kenny Brooks, you know, he has a nice rotation. He subs in and out, but he doesn't often pull a kid out for making a mistake. He wants them to play through it, and he gives them opportunities to start getting that rhythm back. As he talked in that halftime interview, the flow.
Reverse came wide open for Henry.
And nobody cutting her off. Kayla Cooper-Williams just standing there and never actually coming over and allowing Henry to turn her entire body on that reverse layup.
Near steal by Bolden, but it turns into her third foul. Did a good job early second half to avoid picking another up. Remember, did not play the entire second quarter due to foul trouble.
not much contact there either. And that's a tough one for Bree Bolden. And not sure if she was frustrated with the call or frustrated with herself for overstepping a little bit on that closeout.
Castro stepped up and forced the travel from Logan Reynolds.
Logan Reynolds, she doesn't get in too often. Never started a game for JMU, but comes in often with Barron to try to give her a spell on that outside perimeter shooting.
14 minutes per game off the bench. Logan up and under. The help came, and Williams stripped her on the way up.
You see Perez there saying to Micken, let's go, let's go. She wants to get the ball in transition.
Luna Castro blocked it up high, but is called for the blocking foul down low. Don't see that combination very often.
Yeah, that's always a tough one when you're a big and you're stepping in and you're straight up. And I guess she was moving her feet as Mickens was going around her.
Boy, Mickens really has done a nice job changing pace in his second half. That's a tough call on Luda Castro.
Seemed more on Mickens landing that she kind of fell into her after the shot went up. And you're right, that is a really tough call at this point of the game.
Right back to a one-possession game.
And you could just feel the energy in the building. Everybody just kind of waiting. When is JMU going to make that run that they're so well known for?
Most of the fans here clad in purple. They've never had that true chance to be a factor. They've tried. Give them credit.
And Charleston just holding on. And what ends up happening when you have a lead against a better team, you don't want to play not to lose. You want to play to win.
Boom! From the corner.
And if these Raptors were just a little bit lower, that might have hit it. What a high arcing shot there for Booth. But again, when you're Charleston, that's how you play to win. You stay aggressive. You take those shots. You don't want to play not to lose. Big difference in those two philosophies.
Perez passes up what would have been an open three. Guatney ends up with one. Great hustle from both teams, but Perez was out of bounds.
Just love the style of play of Ashley Perez. She's always the one on the floor. She's flipping the ball out, doing whatever she can. And here you see her just fighting for that basketball. Clearly got it away, but went out of bounds before she was able to flick it to her teammate. I love her intensity and tenacity.
Final 2 minutes of this third quarter. Charleston has not trailed. It's been an impressive performance. Booth, a big part of that.
And they're trying to close out this third quarter, much like they started this game, and that's with their bigs. That's with Luna Castro and Booth, and if they can keep attacking down low, it's working.
Largest lead of the second half is Cooper Williams into contact, late whistle. And Booth is down, a little slow to get up. Bit of a grimace there, as you see, and she's asking her to come out.
That would be a big blow right here for Charleston. She's just been so effective.
Well, she took a shot from Guatney late there, did Boo. Officials missed it. Fortunate for Jasmine Guatney. Amazing how Cooper Williams barely even comes to a full stop before she shoots those free throws.
Yeah, if she was a pitcher, that would be a balk.
Right.
Interesting free throw shooting style, though. Usually, you know, some players like to stay put in, and it's either do you jump or do you not jump, but she kind of steps into her shot.
Again, true to her average, though. 1 of 2 there, 2 of 4 for the game. College of Charleston still up 6, final 90 seconds of the third quarter.
You see Booth over there off the court getting some treatment there from her trainer, stretching it. Her legs out a little bit. Hopefully she can come back in the game.
Top left corner of your screen. JMU has done a better job pushing the bigs off the post. 2 to shoot. Offensive board for Gardner. Courtney Gardner. Only 15 minutes per game, but a huge offensive rebound that time.
And great decision to pull it back out and set up another offensive possession.
Holden's been quiet, turns it over as Guatney got the deflection.
Yeah, we talked earlier about closing quarters out well, and JMU looking to get a good shot here.
They had the chance for 2-for-1. Instead, as you said, make sure you get the good look, not just a quick look. Nice feed from Guatney, and Cooper Williams fouled yet again.
And just that really nice vision there by Guatney. Jumping up, everyone thinks she's going to take that shot, and she just dumps it off to Cooper Williams.
And the defense has to step up and stop Guatney because she's become such a scoring threat. Cooper Williams trying to take advantage.
And whenever you have bigs, again, that kids are so athletic and have such great vision, not only making the pass, but have the vision to see and work so well together. A lot of it is a feel for your teammate. You get used to knowing where they're going to be and playing with them over time. And Cooper Williams is a freshman. She doesn't play like a freshman.
Foul was on Gardner, her second. Three Cougars have three fouls each. Huh, Luda Castro and Bolden. And JMU back to within four. Chance to hold for one here for College of Charleston. But first, they have to handle JMU's pressure.
And JMU a little more aggressive in their pressure than Charleston is on theirs. And Noah Henry, lucky she didn't get called for a walk there.
Give College of Charleston credit. The one turnover against the pressure all day, it seems.
Yep.
Bolden clearing out. Final 6 seconds of the quarter. Step back. But after three, we're exactly where we were at the half. Eighth-seeded College of Charleston trying to hold on and rock this. Big shots at big times. They've also played dynamite defense. The Dukes 26% from the field in the first three quarters. 15% from deep. They're just 2 of 13 from distance.
And you just can't say enough, honestly, about, you know, what Luna Castro and Booth have been able to do here today.
Foul on Cooper Williams as she collided with Booth away from the ball. Booth has taken a beating in this second half.
They better have an ice bath ready for her tonight.
Landed awkwardly in that third quarter on the defensive end. And here looked like she took a shot in the jaw.
But she's really forcing Cooper Williams to play her honestly because she can hit that three. She's riding her high, and then Charleston needs to give her the basketball on the low side.
Booth got it blocked by Guatney.
What I like about Guatney when she blocks the shots, they always seem to maintain possession.
Nickens, though, into traffic, and Luna Castro the board.
If you're Charleston, you want to guard against getting in too much of a transition game because that's the tempo JMU wants right now. They want to get it going.
They played a slow tempo second half, really since the end of that opening quarter. Booth fouled and headed to the line as Cooper Williams gives her third of the game.
And that's what she's been doing all game. She's able to hit the turnaround. She's establishing position, and Cooper Williams goes from on the high side, and then she's trying to slip in, but dropping those arms down.
Booth transfer from Siena has really struggled. She's a good foul shooter, 74% on the season. But today, despite the fact that she's done almost everything right in every other facet, she's missed 4 of her 7 foul shot attempts.
And it's kind of funny because she's out there when Jasmine Guatney blocked her shot, she smiled, she was laughing after she missed that first one. She plays with a joy. She's kind of like, well, what are you going to do? Those things happen. You can't tell if she's having a great game or a tough game because she looks the same, has the same composure throughout the game.
She's got a game-high 19. Perez off the dribble. Cooper Williams got away with an over-the-back, but Booth still ends up with a loose ball for Charleston.
Five-point lead with College of Charleston here in the fourth quarter. Seems like a lot, but JMU can erase deficits. They just haven't been able to do it yet today.
As every minute disappears, though, the pressure ratchets up on the top seed. A season's worth of yeoman's work could erase in the blink of an eye. They've won 17 in a row, lost their first conference game, have not lost since. Good block by Cooper Williams, and Perez gets the loose ball.
Yeah, JMU, the bigs playing great, have 3 blocks in the last 2 minutes of the game.
The length of the Dukes cannot be understated. If Guatney can use it offensively, over Booth.
Love the way Guatney is able to create space there. Again, we've seen her hit that kind of fadeaway jump shot, but it's how she can feel the defender on her back and then create space.
Is that the most improved part of her game, that footwork and just the feel offensively?
Yeah, I think that, and I think her ability when things aren't going well to get back in it.
Huff had the wide open look, but Cooper Williams the rebound. Oh, I thought Barron was going to pull the trigger. Instead, Perez will, and JMU has tied it.
And I wouldn't be surprised if Candace Jackson takes a timeout relatively soon. We'll see if she takes a timeout or kind of lets her team play through it. But you knew it was only a matter of time.
Great job by Barron to know her role, Christine.
Yep. Knew it was only a matter of time before JMU kind of got a little run going.
Mickens ends up with a weak side rebound.
Booth actually tipping that ball, Bolden tipping the ball away from Booth.
Mickens goes all the way. Cooper Williams can't hit. Guafney can't give JMU the lead. Neither can Cooper Williams. Oh, my goodness. Perez will try. And Booth, the rebound for Charleston.
Unbelievable. What was that? Six offensive rebounds in that possession alone. It right in front of the rim and nothing going down.
That spray chart just got even uglier for JMU. Candace Jackson wants a timeout. We are tied, but how the Dukes did not go in front, I'm not sure. What a finish. Ashley Perez's three, 42 seconds into the game. It was 3-2. Since then, Charleston has been in front the whole way.
And again, when you're Charleston, you want to have that mindset. Nothing to lose.
Booth. Bolden plus the foul. What a huge shot from the All-CAA performer.
She's been fantastic on defense today, but only 2 points. Struggling offensively. 5 turnovers thus far. But when it counts, she shows up. Great shot.
Again, Charleston hurting itself at the free throw line. However, another miss. The Cougars now 50% for the game.
And those are points, again, you cannot leave those free points out there.
Guatney wide open. Again, JMU missing from point blank range is Booth the rebound.
But I really do love how Jasmine Guatney just keeps shooting. You know, if you're a young player, you know, sometimes players stop shooting. She keeps on shooting.
She's won the most outstanding player in this tournament each of the last 2 seasons. This year she was the best player in the regular season, but she bit on the fake and Luna Castro makes her pay.
She's blocked a lot of shots here today. She's been jumping out of the gym and Luna Castro recognizing that, giving that little shot fake and a little up and under.
And all of a sudden Charleston's back up 4. Final 6 minutes and a steal by Bolden. She took it away from Guatney.
And that's what Bree Bolden does best. She sneaks up on you and she has 91 steals on the season. Unbelievable.
Huge three for Booth. Listen to the underdog crowd, the Delaware fans, the Eli.
Smiling, hitting shots, smiling. Even when she gets her shot blocked, she's smiling. What a joy to watch. I love players that truly you can see the passion and the love they have for the game.
You'd be smiling if you had 22 at this stage of the game as well. Plus, if your team's up by 7, that's the situation for Charleston. Watch JMU during that last timeout, Christine. And Kenny Brooks gave it to his team. And Ashley Perez rewards him with an easy layup. He stayed out of the huddle. He said about 30 seconds worth to his club, and then he let them huddle by themselves on the floor.
And time again, who steps up after those breaks? Ashley Perez. It's been consistent throughout this game. She hits that big shot.
A senior laden club. Mickens, Guatney, and Perez. Jackie Luna Castro is senior, can't hit. Perez in there for the board.
So effective though when you have that step back as a big.
JMU though needs to execute and get good looks offensively. Perez instead turns it over as Henry took it away.
Great defense by Brianna Bolden, moving her feet to just cut her off there. Didn't even use her hands.
And a good decision by Bolden and Henry to slow things up.
2-time CAA Defensive Player of the Year, and she's only a junior.
Henry driving on Cooper Williams, got fouled by Guatney as Guatney tried to come in for the help.
And that's just she tried to swipe with her hand instead of moving her feet because she thought she was going to dish it off. Henry doesn't often go all the way to the basket on plays like that. She thought she was going to give that little dish, so she got a little lazy, swipes it with her hand, doesn't move her feet, foul.
Henry does everything right as a point guard except shoot free throws. Although big make there, only 63% on the season as Griffin returns for JMU. Perez will get a breather.
It's kind of funny to watch as people are entering the arena and they look up at the scoreboard. It looks like astonishment for all the new fans coming in for the later games today.
Elon, Delaware next on CAA.TV. Winner of this will play the winner of that. But right now, believe it or not, it's Charleston up 6, 4.25 to go.
I think if you're JMU, you're looking for Guafmi. You want to establish with Guafmi and Cooper Williams. Look inside, especially with Perez out.
Guafmi, pull up. Big shot, back to within 4.
Again, these bigs on both teams, hitting those mid-range jumpers, that's really kind of been the story of the offensive play for both teams. Luna Castro, Booth, and then Guafmi for JMU.
Going to have to keep scoring here if you're College of Charleston. You know JMU has one more run left in them.
And no lead is ever safe for JMU, but especially 4 with under 4 to go.
8 on the shot clock. Henry creating. How did that not go?
You just wonder which team will have the momentum closing out this game. Which team will be able to hit that big shot?
Each team has 2 timeouts remaining. Guafmi into a double. Luna Castro the rebound and a foul on JMU.
When you look at the foul totals right now, that's JMU's 15th foul of the quarter. College of Charleston doesn't have any.
That's a huge advantage, particularly with a 4-point edge as we'll walk the length. But Charleston has to take advantage and make their free throws. Only 9 of 17 from the stripe on the game. Kenny Brooks continuing to stay positive with Huff Mickens, although he knows time's starting to run down on his club.
But when you think about leaving 8 points out there from the free throw line, but not Brianna Bolden, she nails it.
Bolden 80% as Perez returns. Feel like they need her offense at this point.
Absolutely, and she struggled offensively, not defensively, but offensively. But here in the fourth quarter, she's had some big shots for this team.
She leads the Dukes with 14 points, but on 15 shots, and a lead back to 6 for Charleston.
And the question is, can Charleston get a stop? But if you're JMU, Perez back in the game, spread that floor, Barron, Perez, and then look inside to Cooper Williams and Guafmi.
Guafmi, great feed. Cooper Williams wasn't ready for it, got stripped, but Huff was on the baseline. So it stays with JMU, 13 to shoot.
What great rotation. What great weak side rotation there.
Boy, if the freshman, though, is ready to catch and shoot, it's a layup.
It is, but that back line, great defense. Just wonder, is it time for the player of the year?
Guafmi on the spin.
On cue.
Damn, you look like they didn't know what defense they were in. Half were pressing, half weren't.
This again, when you're Charleston, you want to use the clock, but you don't want to take the air out of the ball. Then you end up flat on your offense.
So right, such a fine line. Again, under 10 to shoot. Bolden working on Cooper Williams, got it blocked, but the foul came. Late whistle.
Wow, very late whistle. Seems like she got a lot of ball, but it wasn't even the call. It was when the call occurred. She gets up, creates space, did get a little bit of the hand, but that's where, right there, that's when they made the call, when she received the basketball on her way down.
Viewing it again, right call, wrong timing.
Exactly.
Bolden, fatigue shouldn't be a factor. She didn't play the entire second quarter. One more look. Ooh, that angle, maybe not. Maybe just a bad call all the way around.
Whew.
And that's why angle is so important for officials. They talk about it all the time. So a 5-point game. Just over 2 minutes remaining. CAA quarterfinal number 1. We still have 3 more to go from the Showplace Arena after this one. Perez. Cooper Williams fought to keep it alive, and it goes off of Charleston.
Seems like Charleston's getting their hands on a lot of those balls, but they just can't grab it cleanly.
Big break for the Dukes. Fresh 32. Guafmi got fouled on the floor. Wave it off, and as you said earlier, that's only the first team foul. So You can be more aggressive here if you're College of Charleston.
You can, and it seemed like they called that on Booth. It seemed like she had good position. Might have been in the restricted area, maybe.
Only the first on Booth. Still three more fouls to give. 2 minutes even left in this one. JMU has not led since the first minute of the game.
The difference is when you have fouls to give versus just giving up fouls.
Perez was wide open. Guatney, big follow, but can't get the finish. Still two shots coming for the conference player of the year.
You just feel the nervous energy here in this on every play. Everybody gasping, holding their breath, and Guatney just getting great position and putting it right back up, just not converting.
Boy, if you're College of Charleston right now, you feel like you keep looking at the clock and almost no time has gone off. And now it's JMU with an untimely miss at the stripe from an 80% free throw shooter. Logan returning for the Cougars. Luna Castro goes out.
Still so much time left, you're right, and it seems like it's not going fast enough for College of Charleston, and for JMU, they want it to slow down.
Guatney does get the roll. That allows the Dukes to set up the full court pressure.
But every foul on JMU now is shooting two.
Crowd has turned against the Dukes all of a sudden. Booth well deep with that one. Cooper Williams, the easy rebound.
Here you wonder, will JMU with two timeouts left, are they going to play through it? Are they going to draw something up?
Instead, a foul on the three-point shooter. Silly one for the Conference Defensive Player of the Year. Bolden's fourth. Three free throws for Perez.
The same referee made that call. Made the one for Brianna Bolden down at the other end. And let's see, she got some of the arm. Like she had a lot of ball there as well.
JMU says we were owed one. Bad timing though for College of Charleston. Perez from Manchester, Connecticut. 14 points per game. She leads all JMU scores with 16 here today. Had a chance to pull the Dukes back to within one.
And all of a sudden everything changes. Minute 18. One possession.
And Kenny Brooks wants the timeout to draw up something defensively here. Now the Duke crowd is returned, trying to make it.
17 straight wins. So are we back where we started, or do they take care of business?
And remember, at the beginning of the year, we were talking about how wide open it was at the top. Precious Hall, the reigning CAA Player of the Year, out for the season. Guatney stepped up in her absence. But boy, do they need somebody to step up now. Contact, no call, big steal. For the lead, Perez! First lead since the opening minute for JMU. Henry. Can't answer. Perez the rebound. She's fouled.
Building just erupting right now. Everyone in purple standing up on their feet. And Ashley Perez, she's hit big shot after big shot after big shot today.
Fourth foul on Jackie Luna Castro. Perez with 20. Still one to give for Charleston, but you don't have to foul. 15-second differential.
Yeah, I think you play it out, and Bree Bolden just saying to her team, calm down, we got this.
One stop, one score, and you can play on, maybe even win. Score here, though, for JMU. Comes awful close to icing it. It's the player of the year. Can't put JMU up four. Bolden the rebound, timeout. Did they get it before the dribble? Can they advance the ball?
The refs are saying that she dribbled it. Yep, she cannot advance it.
So So they'll have to throw it in from the backcourt. Each team now has one timeout remaining. Second time within a 7-day stretch. So you want to talk about an intense scout, to say the least. Watney, big defensively down the stretch. But it was Ashley Perez that hit the huge shot. Henry trying to handle the pressure, does. Boy, they got the timeout as the ball was loose. They had thrown a pass that Booth did not catch cleanly.
But I think that's great coaching right there. Advance, okay, well, we didn't get the advancement. Well, we're going to advance it. Star player. So I'd be looking for both of those. And then if everybody goes flying, look for Booth underneath because she's got a big 22 points.
What a game. What an effort from College of Charleston. And here we go. Down by two. Cougars with a ball. Final 14 seconds. Booth stays with College of Charleston.
She had the lane, just couldn't convert.
They can review this. Final minute, JMU to a man, saying it was off of Booth.
What a heads-up play. What heads-up by JMU players asking for that to be reviewed.
So close, Christine.
Wow.
It just showed the replay, so close. Both players touched it. It's a matter of who touched it last.
And it's one of those cases, the initial call is that it's Charleston ball. If it's inconclusive, you stick with the call.
Great job by everybody to get this shot.
Ooh.
Booth seemed to think she wanted to talk about a game of inches.
Ooh.
Millimeters. Oh, you could say simultaneous. Here we go. Yeah. 9 seconds left.
Booth and Luna Castro. That's who you look for.
No timeouts. Damn you for Watney's deflection.
So much emotion. Bree Bolden just so frustrated.
Got to get up here and foul if you're College of Charleston. Still stationary inbound. Not going to make anything easier near the corner. Perez was pretty good option. 94% of this season.
And that's the thing. So much goes into this. These young players play so hard. They practice so much. And Bree Bolden just letting all of her emotion out of frustration, but passion. But you're right. There was still plenty of time. You got to foul. Foul right away. Try to steal the inbound.
Bolden went to the ball. Just a freak of nature play by Guatney. And then she tipped it off the hands of Bolden. What a play. Great call by the official as well. And there's that point you were making earlier. Guatney was trying to tip it back into play rather than out of bounds.
Right. Perez needs both of these to seal it.
For the win. Hope stays alive for Charleston. Booth at the buzzer. And JMU wins.